Good evening. Welcome to St. Thomas the Apostle Parish. This evening's Mass, our celebrant will be Father Joe Tuscan. The concelebrant is Father Ken Wolf. Our deacon for tonight's Mass is Ed Sheffer. The entrance hymn is number 830 in your missal, number 830. Please stand.
Gathered in the name of Jesus, richer still in unity. Let us bring the gifts that differ, and in splendid varied ways, sing a new church into being, one in faith and love and praise. Risen from the water, robed in holiness and light, male and female in God's image, male and female God's delight. Let us bring the gifts that differ, and in splendid varied ways, sing a new church into being, one in faith and love and praise.
In the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
As we prepare to celebrate these sacred mysteries, let us call to mind our sins. I confess to Almighty God and to you, my brothers and sisters, that I have greatly sinned in my thoughts and in my words, in what I have done and in what I have failed to do, through my most grievous fault. Therefore, I ask Blessed Mary, ever Virgin, all the angels and saints, and you, my brothers and sisters, to pray for me to the Lord our God. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen.
Let us pray. O God, who have accomplished the work of human redemption through the paschal mystery of your only begotten Son, graciously grant that we, who confidently proclaim under sacramental signs the death and resurrection of Christ, may experience continued increase of your saving grace. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God forever and ever.
Amen.
A reading from the first letter of St. Paul to the Corinthians. Brothers and sisters, I received from the Lord what I also handed on to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night he was handed over, took bread. After he had given thanks, broke it and said, "This is my body that is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, also the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the death of the Lord until he comes." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Beside restful waters, he leads me, he refreshes my soul.
The Lord is my shepherd, there is nothing I shall want.
He guides me in right paths for his name's sake. Even though I walk in the dark valley, I fear no evil, for you are at my side with your rod and your staff that give me courage.
The Lord is my shepherd, there is nothing I shall want.
You spread the table before me in the sight of my foes. You anoint my head with oil, my cup overflows. Only goodness and kindness follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord for years to come.
The Lord is my shepherd, there is nothing I shall want.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to John.
Glory to you, Lord.
Since it was preparation day, in order that the bodies might not remain on the cross on the Sabbath, for the Sabbath day of that week was a solemn one, the Jews asked Pilate that their legs be broken and they be taken down. So the soldiers came and broke the legs of the first and then of the other one, who was crucified with Jesus. But when they came to Jesus and saw that he was already dead, they did not break his legs. But one soldier thrust his lance into his side, and immediately blood and water flowed out. An eyewitness has testified, and his testimony is true. He knows that he is speaking the truth, so that you also may come to believe. For this happened so that the scripture passage might be fulfilled. Not a bone of it will be broken. And again, another passage says, they will look upon him whom they have pierced. The gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. This is a very special parish, and I want to thank Father Crino for his invitation to be back with you here, and I hope it's not the last time. We'll see how we do tonight. I want to thank him, and also I found out just a few moments ago that today is his birthday. So let's say a little prayer for Father Crino and the good work that he does here, and that God will give him good health, many more years, and effectiveness in his work. So let's pray. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women. Blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen. St. Thomas the Apostle. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Our Lady of Guadalupe appeared to Juan Diego in 1531. During the same time period, the so-called Reformation was taking place in Europe, and millions of people were deserting the Catholic Church to follow heretical ideas, which led to the bloody 30 Years' War in Europe. Meanwhile, in Mexico, the opposite was true. In the year 1531, the Aztec religion still had a hold on the native people of Mexico. Many felt the gods they had known needed to be placated with human sacrifice. The number of bloody sacrifices in previous generations is innumerable and astronomical. And many of these were blood sacrifices where the beating heart of live victims was pulled out of their bodies by the Aztec priests. Our Lady appeared to a humble peasant who had no power to change anything. But Mary's image spoke volumes to Juan Diego and to the people of Mexico. Her brown skin and deferential posture said that she came for both the Aztec and the Spanish people. She unites the two. She wears a black belt, meaning she's pregnant. She stands on a black moon, which is the Aztec symbol for Mexico. The moon is lifted up by a winged angel, which means that she is a heavenly creature. In the pictographic language of the Aztecs, the image of Our Lady of Guadalupe communicated that the child of her womb is true royalty, and he is more powerful and important than other gods of the Aztecs. By 1541, just 10 years after her appearance to Juan Diego, a historian of the time wrote that 9 million people in Mexico had converted to Catholicism, surpassing the number of people that abandoned their faith in Europe. In a non-bloody way, the people of an entire country were converted. A culture was redeemed. And they left behind their old gods and discovered the truth of the Incarnation. Our Lady of Guadalupe freed an entire people from a culture that had relied on sacrifice of thousands of innocents each year. I mentioned to you some of the aspects of the South Pacific island of New Guinea, where I served as a missionary when our friars arrived there in 1955. And I described them as, intense tribal fighting where people were often killed, polygamous marriages, cannibalism, intense fear of the supernatural. She came from their religious tradition, the animist religious tradition. I'd like to complete the analogy for you for our own culture, because I'm convinced, as I'm going to tell you in a few moments, what converted Melanesian culture to the true religion of Catholicism and liberated them. Because today, you know, in the old photos of the natives of New Guinea when our priests first went over there back in the 1950s, they looked angry. They weren't angry. They were scared to death. Okay? And they were scared of each other. They were scared of outsiders. They were primarily scared that came from their supernatural fear because, you know, what they could intuit, as I said, about what was over there wasn't friendly. And this created these aberrations in the culture. The Catechism of the Catholic Church describes, for instance, polygamy as an aberration of the natural law. It's a sin according to nature, but it's an aberration of the natural law, right? Because God's original plan is the complementarity, not that women are basically sold into as property off to a man, but, you know, the thing in their culture was that you could have as many wives as you wanted. You want to have 7 or 8 wives, great. More wives, more status, okay? But you had to take care of these women. You had to provide for them. You had to protect them, okay? You know, they belonged to you. They were property, but you did have to protect them and care for them, right? Take care of them. They didn't live with you, right? And they were very subservient to you, but you had to provide for them. The Melanesians would look at our culture, what we call the hookup culture, like indiscriminate sexual relationship just for the sake of venereal pleasure. And for them, the act of marriage, the act that can create more people, that defines marriage. Marriage is not essentially a civic issue. It's not a religious issue. It's a natural law issue. Even long before there were missionaries in New Guinea, they would have understood that. And by the way, sins against nature in New Guinea were punishable by death, okay, if people did that. So, but according with polygamy, you know, they would look at our culture and they would call us polygamists. You just don't marry them. They would just call us irresponsible polygamists, okay? But they're the savages, okay? Tribal fighting, we say, well, we don't have tribes in the United States. Well, I would suggest to you that they have different names. We call them Democrats and Republicans, okay? And they're starting to talk in dialects that the other side can't understand anymore, okay? And the fear that's created creates greater and greater division. The division creates violence. Cardinal Seurat is right. When you give up on Jesus, you don't become secular and neutral. You return to the patterns of paganism. When it came to cannibalism, of course, the word horrifies us, but I will tell you, I tried to describe the concept of abortion as it exists in our culture today to my people in the mountains of New Guinea, and they were incredulous with disbelief. In their culture, if you kill someone that's innocent, they would consider you cursed for life, let alone a child. And as I tried to, I don't agree with the pro-abortion position, but I tried to be fair to help them understand it in cultural context, why some people in our culture would consider it a good thing, okay? And try to explain it to them, or at least an unnecessary evil of some kind. They would sit, listen to me, and they couldn't believe it. They said, what did the baby do? And I said, no, it's an unborn child. I said, okay. The mother, she did something. You're punishing her. What did she do? I said, no, she wants to do it. And what was the response? They literally could not wrap their heads around the concept. But they're the savages. Right? I will tell you that abortion is far more common in our culture than cannibalism ever was in theirs. And it ended with a story I'm about to tell you now. I mentioned to you that there's 700 distinct vernacular languages on those islands, another 150 dialects. And when our priests went over there in the beginning, they set to work learning these very complicated ancient tribal languages. And after they started that process, they began to realize they didn't have words for certain things. And among the words they didn't have, for instance, was they didn't have a word for thank you. They had gifts in the culture. Gift giving was in the culture. It was a very particular reason. If you gave a gift, it was because you wanted to have a relationship with someone. So you take a gift, you give it to that person, and now you have a relationship. But the cultural expectation was, I gave you something, now you owe me, okay? And you have to pay back, you have to give me back something that's bigger than what I gave you. And they didn't think anything negative about that. That's how you have a relationship, this sort of back and forth gift exchange, okay? But none of them were free. They all came with the string attached, right? So they understood that. But they didn't have a word for thank you because there's no free gift. The Huli tribe had a phrase, orapili, which means essentially, good job, you've done well. You gave me a gift. Now we have a relationship, right? But the downside is now I got to pay you back. All right. There was no word for thank you because there's no gifts were free. But more profoundly, none of the languages or dialects had a word for forgiveness. And if you know St. Thomas Aquinas, this is easy to figure out eventually. It dawned on the friars. The concept of forgiveness does not exist in natural law, right? When there's an offense, when there's a crime, the instinctive response that we have as broken human beings is, you hurt me, I will destroy you, right? I don't care what size the offense was, you take a pound of flesh out of me, you're dead. That's the natural instinct, okay? A refinement of that is what was in the Jewish culture of the Old Testament. It's called an eye for an eye, a tooth for a tooth, right? This is natural justice. That is, that you only have the right to take from me what I took from you, right? So in a way, we think of eye for an eye, tooth for a tooth, in maybe pejorative ways, but it's actually a refinement of natural justice. But beyond that, the thing is, the relationship was never restored. And they had that. I mean, they all had words for payoff and payback, you know, compensation or retribution. They all had words for those. But it was never restorative. I mean, they were a verbal culture. They never written language. But they never, ever forgot anything. Their minds, if there was a slight offense, they would remember it forever, okay? And you never could really resolve the tension. Every time there was an inevitable offense or something, it just, the tension kept ratcheting up, and there was really no resolution to any of that. There's no way to resolve it, really. And now, the friars tried explaining the concept of forgiveness. So they're explaining the idea of forgiveness to the people. And the people are sitting there going, interesting concept. Why would you do that? You know, what's in it for you? That's a real question. And if you don't have an answer to that question in the mountains of New Guinea in 1955, pack your bag and go home because you're done. It stops there. So it's an honest question. And the priests were looking around and they were trying to find something in the culture to kind of explain this idea and what you benefit from. And they found something by divine providence. And it was a custom of compensation, especially used, it was very costly, but they would use it if they wanted to finally settle fighting, like open fighting between two tribes. And it was a form of exchange. The idea was, normally, they wouldn't do this unless somebody normally was killed, very dramatic. So they would say, well, that was an injustice. We took a person from you, we took their life. We took a person, we'll give you a person. But it wasn't an adult, it was a child. It was a newborn infant. Because an adult would harbor a memory, resentment, right? It had to be a fresh start, a tabula rasa, as we say in Latin. So it was a newborn, and the child was called the child of peace. And the idea was, this child is received by you, intermarrying your tribe, and now, because of that child, our flesh and blood is mixed. So if we ever fight again, we'll be spilling our own blood. And the people heard the friars explain that, and they're like, okay, now we understand. You know, God the Father sends his baby son into the midst of our tribe. Several things happened there. Now we know, first of all, what's over there, because we see him in the flesh, and he speaks to us. And more than just giving us good advice and clarity about the nature of God with that beautiful word, Abba, he helps us, right? He sustains us. He strengthens us through the sacraments. And so we know that God is good because of this. We also know that he's on our side. We also know that he's trying to help us, and that his son abides with us. He's Emmanuel with us and forever, until the end, in this beautiful tabernacle. And I know that seems like a simple concept to us, but try imagine negotiating your relationship, your marriage, or any other relationship without the concept of forgiveness. The concept of forgiveness is defined by this. It doesn't come from nature. There's an old saying, God always forgives, man sometimes forgives, nature never forgives. That is the victory of the cross. It introduces the healing that restores us to the garden. You know, in the Catechism of the Catholic Church, it tells us that when you make a good confession, that your soul is restored to the state of a child at its baptism. Healed fundamentally at the root. That healing is permanent. And now it can be destroyed again by sin. But our Lord knew we would need that help, and he gave us that beautiful sacrament to heal and restore us. And I work with exorcists around the country, and they will tell you that a good confession is more powerful than any formal rite of exorcism that the church has. Because you're willingly giving yourself back to God in an honest way. It's restorative. Conceptually, that was the beginning, but there was something else that happened that really won over the people to the faith. And it's the very thing in our culture that is under attack. It's the very basic structure, and you all know what it is. It's you. It's families. The concept of the family is the point of attack in our culture today. And I hope that we can get the Confraternity of Christian Mothers restarted in this parish. In fact, I was looking on our website, our database. We once had 7 Confraternities of Christian Mothers in this diocese of Tucson. I hope we can get it restarted here. Okay? It's a defense of marriage. And in fact, not only would I say that the structure, basic structure of the family is the point of attack in the culture, it's women. Women are at the point of that attack, right? In the culture. When they found out that Catholic marriage was, you marry somebody your own age whom you love, and you choose, and you live in the same house with that person, and you raise your little babies together in the same house together, first of all, the girls were like, really? And even the boys, because they could never have even expected to have a wife until they were middle-aged almost, and be able to afford to buy wives, okay? That is what just won their hearts. I mean, it was merit, it was love. It was love. We couldn't keep up. We only sent 5 priests. The early priests told us we could not keep up with all these villages coming to pull us out to these remote places to tell them the Christian story. Far from us imposing Christianity on, you know, this noble savage culture, right? Far from that, we couldn't keep up with the demand of them, because if you go to Papua New Guinea today, you don't see anxiety and fear in people's faces. You see smiles all over the place, okay? Very welcoming people. That's a product of Christianity. They were delivered from servile fear. There's people are still sinners. They still go to confession, okay? I heard thousands and thousands of confessions when I was in New Guinea. But it was the sacraments that freed, that converted the culture, and it was marriage. It's ironic. And so my proposal to you is that a reinvestment in the basic concept of marriage, because what is a parish except a collection of families? And the parish is only as healthy as the families are healthy. And a culture is only as healthy as the family is healthy. And the culture, you're not going to get this message, but the culture is dependent on believers to form healthy, functioning Catholic families, good families. That, if you do that, if you work on your marriages, work on your parenting, you know, work with your children, formation, it's the family. It is the family that will ultimately reconvert the culture. It's love, it is charity, the highest of the virtues. It needs that structure, that concept needs forgiveness. Dr. Rick Fitzgibbons is a Catholic psychologist. He's a professor of the field, and he lives outside of Philadelphia. But he wrote a book for his colleagues some years ago called Helping Clients Forgive. And he makes a distinction in there between reconciliation and forgiveness. He said, forgiveness is something you can always do. Reconciliation, not always possible, because that takes two people. Sometimes the person who hurt us is dead. Sometimes the person who hurt us is mentally incapacitated. Sometimes the person who hurt us is emotionally very wounded. There's a saying in the field, hurt people hurt people, okay? And so it's not always possible to have reconciliation, because sometimes there's something missing. When it is possible, it's brilliant, it's incredible. But that doesn't mean you have to live in the prison of forgiveness the rest of your life. There's an old saying, when you don't forgive somebody, it's like swallowing poison and expecting the other person to die, right? But some relationships are toxic, and it's not possible to be reconciled. But he says this, Dr. Fitzgibbon, the people we fail to forgive become our masters. We're like string puppets. When we don't forgive, it's like they're manipulating the sticks and we're dancing like that. Cut the strings. I'm going to tell you how. The true lesson of forgiveness, well, let me just say this. There's a piece of native in all of us. And we feel like if I forgive somebody, okay, Father, I understand the concept. But I feel like if I forgive the person that hurt me, they're getting away with it. You know, there's a little native instinctiveness in all of us. And the thing is forgiveness is not approving of somebody else's crime or sin. When you forgive somebody, you're not saying your crime or your sin is okay, right? You're just saying, I'm not going to take your punishment on myself. You did the crime. You did the sin. I'm not taking the punishment for it. I'll pray for you, right? If you're wondering if God is just, we've talked a lot about God's mercy. If you're wondering if God is just, yes, he is, right? People will answer for their sins and their crime. You don't have to worry about that. Question is you, are you going to destroy yourself in the process? Forgiveness is not covering over people's sins. It's not, in the psychology field, you call that codependency or denial. That's not forgiveness. The true lesson of forgiveness, as I said, we learn from the cross. So I would say, Archbishop Sheen said that our Lord preached his greatest sermon from the cross. I would suggest to you that that sermon has two parts. First, it is not a lesson, a teaching, but a demonstration of the virtue that our Lord said would be among those who would inherit the earth, meekness. The virtue of meekness is defined as power held in reserve for the sake of another. In his case, that would be divine meekness, second person of the Blessed Trinity, and by extension, the Eternal Father's self-restraint over what we tried to do to his son on the darkest day in history. They beat him up, they nailed him to the wood, he's up there hanging, he's dying, and they're taunting him. If you're really God, get off that cross. He could have destroyed them, but he didn't, right? He restrained his power, his, in fact, just power over us. And the thing is, it wasn't just the people that did that to him 2,000 years ago. Every time we sin, we contribute to his crucifixion, right? It says in the Garden of Gethsemane that he sweat blood and water because he could perceive all the sins of mankind would ever commit. And he sweat for our own sins in the Garden of Gethsemane as he anticipated his great sacrifice. And then he followed that up by what is the completing motion of forgiveness. He prayed for us. He said, Father, forgive them. They don't know what they're doing. Right? So that's the model for us. Forgiveness is first of all an act of the will. I will not do to you what you did to me. I'm not going to return in kind the evil. And then you pray for the person. You've done that, you've forgiven them. I suggest to you that in my 27 years as a priest, the bigger pastoral issue is people know that, but what they can't do is forget. They have lingering feelings over past wounds. There's a healing for us in that. In St. Matthew's Gospel, in chapter 18, verses 21 to 22, when Peter approached our Lord and said, Lord, how often shall my brother sin against me and I forgive him? As many as seven times? And of course, our Lord said to him, not seven times, but 70 times seven times. Now remember, St. Peter was referring to the Old Testament book of Proverbs, where it says, the just man sins seven times a day. Okay? So what St. Peter was referring to is, that's the model of the just, right? Not meaning not just ordinary thing. In other words, we offend each other on average seven times a day, okay? That's the nature of human brokenness. That was the model. So St. Peter thought he was being generous, that this is like all the times that people offend each other in the course of a day. But our Lord said, no, more than that. To even include mortal sins, right? You are not defeated by another person's sins, so that you are not defeated. St. Francis of Assisi, in his admonition to the brothers, admonition number 9 to be exact, he said, the person truly loves his enemy who is not hurt by an injury done to him, but because of the love of God, is stung by the sin of his own soul, let him show his enemy love by his deeds. Deeds, okay? You don't think yourself into a new way of acting. You act yourself into a new way of feeling, okay? Acta, in Latin we say, acta non verba. Actions, not words. Don't tell me you love me, just give me the flowers, okay? Saint Therese of Lisieux said, I know that true charity consists in bearing all our neighbor's defects, not being surprised by their weaknesses, but edified by their smallest virtues. Right? There is scripture for this. Matthew 5:44, love your enemies, pray for those who persecute you. Romans 12:9, love and do good to the offender. Romans 12:14, don't speak poorly of the offender. Romans 12:17-19, release them from your punishment. Proverbs 24:17, don't celebrate their failures. Luke 6:31, treat them the way you want to be treated. Isaiah 43:18, stop dwelling on the past. So if you want freedom, you want to be liberated from the oppression that sin brings into this world, God doesn't give us just good advice. He gives us the healing that comes in the sacraments. He gives us the sacrament of confession. Another aspect of forgiveness I would suggest to you in my pastoral work as a priest is that, and I mentioned this earlier in the retreat, people can't forgive themselves. That's, in fact, it's more pernicious. That's what I found. The issue of forgiving others, it's difficult, but I think more destructive and self-destructive especially. People can't forgive themselves for their own sins, even if they've gone to confession. Even if they've heard these words from the sacred text, they can't bring themselves to, they can never forgive themselves for things they've done in the past, even though they've been absolved. I can't tell you how many times in the last 27 years, as a confessor, I've heard something to the effect of, "Father, I don't know how to go to confession because every time I go to confession, I keep confessing the same sins over and over." My instinctive response to that is, what do you want to do? Confess something new? Every time you go to confession? And it's not like the list of the seven deadly sins is a checkoff list. You don't have to hit them all before you die. In the spiritual life, we have what is called the primary fault. This is not always what I call people's favorite sins or habitual sins. Sometimes those are coping mechanisms. For instance, a man has a problem with anger. He can't resolve it. He can't deal with it. So he acts out in self-destructive ways. Alcohol, sex, food, whatever, impulsiveness, self-destructive. But those are coping mechanisms because he can't deal with the primary fault. If he did, those things would be non-issues, right? And so, that's where confession comes in, because it heals on that root level. That's why Padre Pio was so good at, he could read souls, right? He could tell people their sins, even if they didn't remember even what they were. But here's the beautiful thing. You don't have to have Padre Pio as your confessor for this to work. Any priest who is validly ordained and says the formula of absolution properly will bring this gift to you. You just have to show up regularly for confession. And that process becomes deeper and deeper. The healing becomes deeper and deeper. There's a difference between guilt and feelings of guilt. Okay? When you commit a sin, you have guilt. You've committed the sin, you're guilty. Okay? And there's punishment for guilt. Every sin is a sin against charity. Venial sins wound charity. Mortal sins, the Catechism teaches, destroy charity. Confession repairs charity, but often there are wounds that we call the corporal effects of sin. That is, you know, someone says, they come into the confession, they say, "Well, I cheated on my taxes." So they get absolved for manipulation or for deception, lying, and he's absolved, for the sin's gone. Government officers show up at your house, say, "Well, you have to spend a few years in federal penitentiary for that." Okay, external corporal effect of sin. You know, somebody commits adultery and they confess their sin, they're absolved of that sin, but they go home, their spouse leaves them. Okay, corporal effect, external corporal effect of sin. But there's a more pernicious way that the corporal effects of sin can affect us, and that is these feelings of guilt that linger. Those are also a corporal effect of sin. You can use those actually to your advantage, because St. Teresa of Avila, this is not new, this is since the time immemorial. St. Teresa of Avila used to say, "When the devil reminds you of your past, you remind him of his future." Okay? There's an old saying, every saint has a past, every sinner a future, right? And so when the devil provokes you with thoughts over past sins, you claim the victory of the cross and you say, "Jesus, thank you for your mercy. Jesus, I love you," right? And you don't give in to that self, because he's going to keep doing it. He's the shamer. He's the accuser, right? And in his face, you just say Jesus. You don't talk to him. You just say, Jesus, I love you. Jesus, thank you for your mercy. The devil hates the holy name. Because of your baptism, you have the power to use it. Do so. St. Francis de Sales, great master of the spiritual life, used to say, do not lose courage in considering your own imperfections, but instantly set about remedying them. Consider all the past as nothing and say, like David, now I begin to love my God. In the film that began our mission and our retreat, you heard the story of Rudolf Haas, the infamous commandant of Auschwitz. And what a magnificent story in that resolution. I would like to tell you another aspect of that story that has to do with our Capuchin priests. And the Nazis killed about 9,000 priests and religious at Auschwitz, Catholic priests and religious. Among them were Polish members of my order, Polish Capuchins from Krakow, Poland. Pope St. John Paul II canonized them as a group a few years ago. We refer to them as the martyrs of Auschwitz. But some of these Polish Capuchins survived in the camp until the end of the war when the Russian soldiers came to liberate the camp. And some of them were in Rome about 15 years later with the superior of my province in Pittsburgh, Father Robert McCreary, who was my novice master and brilliant and very holy man. And they were in class together in Rome. While they were together, they were telling him what happened to them at Auschwitz. And while they were there, Joseph Mengele, the infamous Nazi scientist, was in the camp, and he was using these priests and brothers for medical experiments. And what he was doing to them could have only been described as torture. And it was very degrading. And the way we went through it every day. And Father McCreary said to these Polish priests, how are you people alive, let alone sane? And they told him what happened. During their time there, one of the guards, a Nazi, but he was a Catholic. And he would smuggle them just a thimble full of wine and a little piece of bread. And clandestinely and from memory, they would celebrate the Mass. No beautiful altar or books or vestments, just in their minds. And they said, we clung to the Eucharist because we knew that if we gave in to the righteous anger and indignation over what had been done to us, they wouldn't just have our bodies, they would have our souls. And we weren't giving them our souls. And we clung to Jesus in the Eucharist. And they were liberated long before the Russian soldiers ended up liberating the camp at the end of the war. They walked out of their whole people because of the power of the sacrament of Holy Communion. It transformed a crazy world in the 1940s. Just like Our Lady of Guadalupe, through the gift of her beloved Son and our Savior, transformed the new world. The sacraments have power. Prayer has power. History is a constant witness to that hope. And you and I have the privilege of once again celebrating it this evening. Let us pray. Good and gracious God, you give us the gift of faith, and you give us the gift of your Son in this holy sacrament of the altar. As we celebrate this evening in gratitude for our parish retreat and all the hopes that we have for our families and for the future of our culture and our country and our world, we ask you to hear our desperate pleas on behalf of all those that we love and all those that are lost, and we ask you to bring to healing all that is broken once again in the name of your Son and our blessed Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Saint Thomas the Apostle. Pray for us. Oh, I have to give you the apostolic blessing. The Lord be with you. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May he show his face to you and be gracious to you. May he turn his countenance towards you and give you his peace and blessing. In the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Please be seated.
Please join in our offertory hymn, number 776 in your green missal, Ubi Caritas, number 776.
My sacrifice and yours may be made acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. Amen. Celebrating the memorial of our salvation, we humbly beseech your mercy, O Lord, that this sacrament of your loving kindness may be for us the sign of unity and the bond of charity through Christ our Lord. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks. Lord, Holy Father, almighty and eternal God, through Christ our Lord. For at the Last Supper with his apostles, establishing for the ages to come the saving memorial of the cross, he offered himself to you as the unblemished lamb and the acceptable gift of perfect praise. Nourishing your faithful by this sacred mystery, you make them holy, so that the human race, bounded by one world, may be enlightened by one faith and united by one bond of charity. And so we approach the table of this wondrous sacrament, so that bathed in the sweetness of your grace, we may pass over to the heavenly realities here foreshadowed. Therefore, all creatures of heaven and earth sing a new song in adoration, and we, with all the hosts of angels, cry out, and without end we acclaim.
Holy,
Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest.
To you, therefore, most merciful Father, we make humble prayer and petition through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, that you accept and bless these gifts, these offerings, these holy and unblemished sacrifices, which we offer to you firstly for your holy Catholic Church. Be pleased to grant her peace, to guard, unite, and govern her throughout the whole world. Together with your servant Francis, our Pope, Edward, our Bishop, and all those who holding to the truth and on the Catholic and Apostolic faith.
Remember, Lord, your servants and all gathered here whose faith and devotion are known to you. For them we offer you this sacrifice of praise, or they offer it for themselves and all who are dear to them, for the redemption of their souls in hope of health and well-being, and paying their homage to you, the eternal God, living and true. In communion with those whose memory we venerate, especially the glorious ever-Virgin Mary, Mother of our God and Lord Jesus Christ, and blessed Joseph, her spouse, your blessed apostles and martyrs, Peter and Paul, Andrew, James, John, Thomas, James, Philip, Bartholomew, Matthew, Simon, and Jude, Linus, Cletus, Clement, Sixtus, Cornelius, Cyprian, Lawrence, Chrysogonus, John and Paul, Cosmos and Damien, and all your saints. We ask that through their merits and prayers and all things, we may be defended by your protecting help.
Therefore, Lord, we pray, graciously accept this oblation of our service, that of your whole family order our days in your peace. Command that we be delivered from eternal damnation and counted among the flock of those you have chosen. Be pleased, O God, we pray, to bless, acknowledge, and approve this offering in every respect. Make it spiritual and acceptable so that it may become for us the most holy body and blood of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ. On the day before he was to suffer, he took bread in his holy and venerable hands. With eyes raised to heaven to you, O God, his almighty Father, giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took this precious chalice in his holy and venerable hands. Once more giving you thanks, he said the blessing, gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith.
When we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim your death, O Lord, until you come again.
Therefore, O Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of the Blessed Passion, the resurrection from the dead, and the glorious ascension into heaven of Christ, your Son, our Lord, we, your servants and your holy people, offer to your glorious majesty from the gifts that you have given us, this pure victim, this holy victim, this spotless victim, the holy bread of eternal life, and the chalice of everlasting salvation. Be pleased to look upon these offerings with a serene and kindly countenance, to accept them as ones who are pleased to accept the gifts of your servant Abel the just, the sacrifice of Abraham, our father in faith, and the offering of your high priest Melchizedek, a holy sacrifice, a spotless victim. In humble prayer, we ask you, Almighty God, command that these gifts be borne by the hands of your holy angels to your altar on high in the sight of your divine majesty, so that all of us who through this participation at the altar receive the most holy body and blood of your Son may be filled with every grace and heavenly blessing through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Remember also, Lord, your servants who have gone before us with a sign of faith, and rest in the sleep of peace. Grant them, O Lord, we pray, and all who sleep in Christ, a place of refreshment, light, and peace. To us also, your servants, who though sinners, hope in your abundant mercies, graciously grant some share in fellowship with your holy apostles and martyrs, with John the Baptist, Stephen, Matthias, Barnabas, Ignatius, Alexander, Marcellinus, Peter, Felicity, Perpetua, Agatha, Lucy, Agnes, Cecilia, Anastasia, and all your saints. Admit us, we beseech you, into their company, not weighing our merits, but granting us your pardon through Christ our Lord.
Through whom you continue to make all these good things, O Lord. You sanctify them, fill them with life, you bless them, and bestow them upon us. Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. At the Savior's command, informed by divine teaching, we dare to say,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, As we forgive those who trespass against us, and lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await with joyful hope the blessed coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever.
Lord Jesus Christ, you said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you. Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church. Graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever. The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
Let us offer each other a sign of Christ's peace.
You take away the
Behold the Lamb of God, behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb.
Our communion hymn is number 671, On Eagle's Wings, number 671.
Lest you
Let us pray. May sharing at the heavenly table sanctify us, Lord, we pray, so that through the body and blood of Christ, the whole family of believers may be bound together through Christ our Lord. There were a number of people before Mass waiting for confession, so I will go back to the confessional. Maybe Father will join me also. And I want to thank Father Ken for his gracious presence this evening, Deacon, for your leadership and invitation as well. And thank you for your help for our wonderful seminary students. We have, as I said, 20 young men studying to become Capuchin priests and brothers in my province, really blessed by that. And we have some very wonderful and holy retired priests and brothers, and I thank you for your kindness toward them as well. There's a special blessing here. The Lord be with you.
Please bow your heads and pray for God's blessing.
May God, who by the resurrection of his only begotten Son was pleased to confer on you the gift of redemption of adoption, give you gladness by his blessing.
Amen.
May he by whose redeeming work you have received the gift of everlasting freedom make you heirs to an eternal inheritance.
Amen.
And may you who have already risen with Christ in baptism through faith, by living in a right manner on this earth, be united with him in the homeland of heaven.
Amen.
May the blessing of Almighty God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit descend upon you and remain with you forever.
Amen.
Go in peace, glorifying the Lord by your life. Alleluia, alleluia.
Thanks be to God. Alleluia, alleluia.
Please join in our recessional hymn, number 844, for the healing of the nations, number 844.
Four.